We have a lot of Overwatch to get through today. The Overwatch League 2021 playoffs, baby. Yeah. So let's get into it. I cannot wait for this one. I truly do believe it's going to be a gigabanger.
Oh, I think
teams.
So too.
As the points I've already said, Philly heating up at the right time, finally getting that synergy, the improvements that I'm expecting them to be able to make from one to the other, and then the Gladiators finally getting over that hump, finally getting that win on the board as well, the major win, I should say.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Now it's all coming together here, right at the tail end of the season.
As long as the Philadelphia Fusion perform in this match, up to how they were performing at the end during the play-ins when they were able to beat the Seoul Dynasty, and if they've even improved, this match is slated to just be incredible. Brett, Do you know the last time the Gladiators lost? They're on a 7-match win streak, right? They lost 2-3 to the Atlanta Reign before that. The last time they won without going to map 5, the last time they got beaten significantly was over 100 days ago. They have not been beaten except by map 5s for 100 days. I mean, that is something special.
That
the Gladiators simply, since the beginning of the league, have been heating up. And now at this point, towards the end of the league, they look like one of the best teams. I mean, they are number one in terms of team fight win percentage as well. If we're talking about peaking at the right time, and the fact that meta is looking pretty similar to how it did in the Countdown Cup, this team is scary good. Yes. They're looking like one of the favorites.
All right, well, I need to get this game underway. I mean, enough talk from us as well. Let's introduce the first team. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together virtually for the Philadelphia Fusion.
The Fusion are back. They're contenders once more. Fusion look reinvigorated.
Carpe has come to play today, man.
EQO. Oh, he takes the backside.
Masterclass by the damage dealers of the Philadelphia Fusion.
The Philadelphia Fusion will push it through. Hotma has the alley. Oh, are you kidding? Alarm does it all. One of the very best players in the entire Overwatch League. The Fusion are back. They're contenders once more. Rascal manages to find 4. Both supports, both tanks.
And for the Philadelphia Fusion, this is another team that's been plagued by inconsistencies over the course of the season, mainly down to them not having the available pieces, the roster that they did end up picking up because of a variety of visa issues. But now coming towards the end of the season, they've got a lot of their pieces in and working together. This is the time that they need to shine.
And you can see Shockwave in the starting lineup. They have a rotating cast, DPS. They've got the three of them. I mean, Carpe, Shockwave, and then also EQO. The missing piece of the puzzle is still Poco, but Hopper has been putting up the best performances of his career this year to keep the Fusion in it, to help them get towards the playoffs where they can really start moving more towards reaching their potential.
Yeah.
Everyone knows that this team has the ceiling to be excellent. We saw it last year. They were the number one team coming out of the regular season in the North American division. And they haven't really made that many adjustments to their roster, only really the main tank having a significant swap. So this team is one to be respected. The question is, how close are they to that theoretical ceiling? Have they continued to develop and make improvements since the end of the regular season?
I've got some tough opponents waiting for them on the other side of things. Please welcome the Los Angeles Gladiators.
He is on the warpath. This purple squad, they are on such a heater. This is the Gladiators that was promised in the preseason.
Face! That is a gigantic self-destruct.
Oh my god! That was barbaric!
Now,
Kempster! Oh no! Gladiators are getting everything they want! Shimu's been taken out! I don't believe that!
As the Gladiators look better than ever!
For the Gladiators, I mean, this is a team that is heating up at the right time. Finally, the pieces coming together, and they are putting up some dominant performances. Truly, honestly, the DPS line and talent that's stacked on the Gladiators is really, just honestly, probably the biggest threat coming into this. But it's almost like the double whammy. You've got to worry about the DPS duo of Kevster and Birdering, and also Shu and Skewed in the backline.
Yeah, that backline is one of the only ones that I would put up on the same level as Alarm and Funny Astro. Yeah. It's crazy how good Shu and Skewed have looked playing together. And the fact that you have the former, like, a defending champion player, a goated support, Moth, it's frequently being sat on the bench for this shoe-skewed backline to be able to perform. And this double flex support that they run so often, with skewed often picking up Brigitte, but also having that ability to flex over and play Zen, for example, powered them to a win in the Countdown Cup, where they looked so, so scary. Like I said, Bren, they have the highest teamfight win rate over the course of the entire league this year, partly because they are the best in the league at converting their first picks into teamfight wins. 40% of the time, Gladiators just do that. They get the first pick, and then they win the team fight. That is a huge amount. That's the highest in the league for being able to just control the team fight from the very beginning to the end.
I can see it's all smiles. Nice and cool and calm, honestly, for Gladiators. And, you know, a bit of fun as well at the end of the day. You are still in Hawaii. Map 1, going to be Ilios here. Of course, the Gladiators get to pick this. They're the number 4 seed compared to the number 7. Higher seed gets to pick where they go to first. And of course, as we've been saying the entire time so far on the broadcast, it is loser's pick in this format here for the playoffs.
I don't anticipate these teams playing the same level of Reinhardt-Rush matchups as we saw in the Justice-Dallas game. Both teams are very, very comfortable playing ball Zen compositions. If I had to place a bet, I think it would be in that kind of direction, the flow of this match. But both are very flexible as well, and we've seen them play a ton of Orisa comps too. That was one of the biggest things that I was noticing from the Countdown Cup performances of both these teams, is how willing they were to go from ball Zen comps to Orisa-based stuff. And I think we're going to see a clash of two teams that are happy to swap up comps to try and counter their opponents, get value from their backline, have explosive frontline players too. I think this is going to be an absolute treat. And of course, you've got two players as well hailing from Europe at the very tip of the spear, Shockwave v. Kevster, which I am so looking forward to. I mean, just talking recently in an interview with Shockwave, he was saying that his main focus here was to shut down Kevster and take him out of the game, which is going to be a crucial and yet so difficult task.
Yeah, upcomer coming up with all the juice as well, a lot of lovely player interviews that they've been putting out as well. But here we have it, map number 1 underway. And it is going to be the ball compositions here with the Zen and the Brig into the backline. Backline for both of these squads. Just firing off the shots. What a change of pace as well compared to the first match that we've already seen today with these compositions. It's slow and steady, just looking for the right opportunity. Hopper is going to be taken out, and that's Muse just rolling right through them onto the ball as well, setting up all of that disruption.
They were so close to dropping Skewed early on there, but Carpe, he's taken down both tanks. I don't think they're going to be able to contest this, though, as the Gladiators take control of the objective. Shockwave moving from Ashe to Echo, both of which were unavailable in our hero pools for the Countdown Cup. So Shockwave making sure that he's getting the most use out of the much more open hero pool now.
Look at the damage that he's pumping in as well. Kev's almost getting taken out there just from the try shots going his way. Shockwave, such a skilled player as well. First time we've cast Philly all season, Josh.
The Zen diff.
Oh, I mean, he's just set it up there. Not sure if that was a volley or just a straight shot. Matters not. Shu taken out. Transcendence is going to be free. That's a great pulse bomb, though. Kevster to try and turn things around. Muse in the backline as well. That coordination with both Muse and Kevster is doing so much work. And despite the Philadelphia Fusion capping up this objective, they're not going to be holding on to it for much longer.
Yeah, a couple of things to point out there. First, that Alarm is outpacing Shu when it comes to damage done and translating that into Transcendence usage. Not only was he able to get the pick, but the trance up was great. The problem is the Gladiators are so smart. They just wait it out and collapse on him afterwards. The coordination between Muse and Kevster looking phenomenal. 45% here for Gladiators to be able to start this one going. And with the trance kind of forced to be saved for Shu, he's pushing his way into the front line.
Yeah, he knows he can just use it right away. Discord Orb already placed onto the back line. You see Alarm just trying to cut off the line of sight, so it gets taken off of him, but he has to try and support the rest of his team. The team fight's done and over, honestly, though. The mines scattered across Muse. He does get that pick onto Hotper. We're holding close. Very aggressive defense from them as well, just trying to not let the Fusion get back into this one for free.
At any point here, Muse can go for a pile drive, Kevster with a pulse as well.
Self destruct.
There's a self destruct as well. Muse is so weak.
What?
How on earth does that catch two? These ults are so good from the Gladiators.
Incredible. They do give up the point for it. The fusion flip it over, but I mean, that's three easy picks going their way. What a self destruct from Space. I mean, that lineup was just impeccable.
Now there's a lot of pressure on the fusion. This is final fight territory. Shockwave, after making the swap over to Echo, gets his first duplicate online. There's many different options that they can go for, and here comes the rally engage. Trying to push the Gladiators back, but Skew dances with his own, and Shockwave has duplicated the D.Va.
Yeah, Shockwave just trying to build up that self-destruct if he possibly can. Hack going to be laid out onto him as well. It's a manual one. Pushed him away. Does have the self-destruct, so can now send it straight up into the sky. It's perfectly placed, actually. Right into the doorway, but no kills to be gained. Overtime still cooking, and the Philadelphia Fusion, they want to try and convert this into something a little bit more here, but the Gladiators, they're still in this one. And with Carpe falling, it's steadily going into their direction. That self-destruct pushes them all away for but a moment. Hopper, though, hacked up, is very susceptible to being jumped onto. But it's the Fusion, who don't even touch the objective to keep the overtime going. It looks like they were winning the tail end of that fight as well.
Yeah, that's a bit of a brutal one for Fusion, but I think we can agree that the Gladiators had the control of the tempo in terms of that entire first round. They forced the Fusion away from their composition early. Shockwave moved away from Ash, Hopper moved away from Sigma, and that slower-paced comp got pulled to pieces. The Gladiators are a hyper-aggressive team. Even when they're playing Orisa stuff, they're still aggressive, because Space provides them all of this room with which to work. Take a look at his self-destruct here. Just,
I mean, this is so
threading the needle through, combined with the pile drive. Gorgeous set play from the Gladiators. Space is absolutely the most aggressive D.Va that we have in the league, and he's one of the biggest reasons that the Gladiators has this style.
Coordination between him and Muse as well. You got to remember, Muse coming into this league as well. It didn't really have the synergy built up early on, but it's definitely there now.
Yeah, he's looking like a great player. Bit of a shaky rookie at the beginning half of the season, but he is so good at the moment. And already, they're applying pressure to this backline, not allowing Alarm and Funny Astro space.
Yeah, pushed away, though. Shield Bash stopping them. Kev'Sa just hunting for one individual target. There you go. Look at that. The damage that they're just putting into Carpe, forcing him to step away. What a power drive. And a tech is there from Mano. Just about caught onto Muse just to keep him locked up onto the point for but a moment. Alarm falling, though, is never ideal for the Fusion. They do rely on him quite a bit to put in that extra damage at the Discord Orb. It'll be a struggle now for them. Still, the Gladiators, yeah, they are just slowly squeezing out this team fight. It's in their control with those two picks.
These tanks from the Gladiators are making an enormous amount of pressure and forcing the positioning of the Philadelphia Fusion much more passively than they would like. Space gets really aggressive, and Muse coordinates all the time with Kev'Sa, with Space, with Birdring, just creating a lot of pressure with these pile drives, and the Fusion can't really respond in a good manner. Carpe can't peel away Kev'Sa, Shockwave isn't getting too much value. Again here, the Gladiator's going a little aggressive, peeling back once Space gets the Discord Orb on him.
Yeah, the pile drive from Mano there didn't get too much, I don't think.
Great
start. That's
Kev'Sa,
what a shield bash. Funny Astro, the timing on that one just completely interrupted that pulse bomb. It's available for them to turn this around now. Funny Astro just trying to survive. He's almost built up this rally. Shu, but the Transcendence didn't get too much done with it, just to keep the team alive.
But they're buying time for Birdring's EMP.
They certainly are. There's EMP straight in. The power drive is still connected, though. Mano, I think possibly the only person that's actually going to be connecting onto him, and still is getting hacked up. Can't really do too much. Still kept alive, but eventually bursted through. Carpe needs to do a bit here. Needs to take down his adversary, but right now forced out the recall from both of them. Needs to take the 1v127 out for the beatdown. Kev'Sa taken out of the fight, but still the Gladiators in control. This is a very, very drawn-out team fight, but it should be going away at a fusion off the back of these pickoffs. You'd think, anyway.
Carpe's doing a lot of work.
No way!
But Shu is also going crazy. Shu took down Alarm and Carpe in the midst of that fight, and the Gladiators maintaining control. Only just now does it flip in favor of the fusion.
They still want to fight.
But this fight does not look great. The Gladiators can come zipping straight back in.
Yeah, the mines are scattered across the point. It is going to push the Gladiators away for but a moment, so control's still available there for them. But Hopper, I mean, that's going to be the D-Mech. Has to use the self-destruct. Just trying to survive on 1 HP, though, but Space, it's going to be a quick little tickle, and Hopper sent straight back to the spawn once more. Alarm back in the fight, though, and again, this is still potentially winnable for them. It is a scattered fight taking place all over the map right now, but Space, look at that aggression, just following up on his team. All the damage being done by the Gladiators here, still in complete control.
Alarm picked off, the backline pushed into an awful position, and the Gladiators in final fight territory, taking this first map with a dominant showing. The Fusion's DPS, aside from that clutch from Carpe, where he tried to turn things in his favor by taking the 1v1 against Kevster, Shockwave and Carpe really haven't been able to do anything in these fights. 95% of the Gladiators in firm control. Birdring scouting out the pathing of Alarm and Funny Astro. There's the EMP. What the heck happened to that? Yeah. Birdring got nothing out of it.
Got nothing. I think the Philadelphia Fusion's backline were playing in the doorway, so they just completely avoided it, sidestepped it. An opportunity for them to come back into this fight, and they flipped the point back over. It's not over yet. The Philadelphia Fusion not going down without a fight. The pulse bomb, it is going to connect, but unfortunately, not getting too much done with it, and it's the Gladiators. What a hack onto Carpe. Could not go anywhere. Shu as well, just diving so deep into the backline, using that transcendence to push his way forward. He's going to get sent straight off the edge of Ilios here, but as the overtime trickles down to nothing, it's map number one to the Gladiators here. Their synergy was just fantastic between the tanks, between the DPS, and all of that coming together now. You can see the Gladiators are truly, truly alive into this playoffs. A scary team, a scary competitor moving into this series.
We definitely knew that their form would be good. They are the most recent hoisters of the trophy. The Countdown Cup went in their favor, as the Philadelphia Fusion weren't able to get to Hawaii at any point. This is their first attempt at being able to fight for anything. And they're down 0-1 in this series already. The Gladiators look so, so scary.
Yeah, poised to really get a bit of momentum behind them and potentially take this series with another map on the board. We're going to find out, though. It's not over just yet for the Fusion. Plenty of opportunities in this series after this break to see if they can work their way back into it.
Coca-Cola is the official refreshment of the Overwatch League.
break everybody in the Philadelphia Fusion. Well, it's going to take a bit for them to get back into this series. Of course, playing from Seoul, South Korea as well. Truly a global league here. And you can see the Philadelphia Fusion as well. A couple of players out of their seats. I wonder what that's going to mean as well moving forward into this one. Definitely could make some substitutions for them. But here is their team facility in Seoul, South Korea. Opportunities for them to come back into this series.
There absolutely are. And there's a lot of history with this matchup as well as we take a look at the former winners of the Overwatch League. There is one more place, one more banner remaining. And this Gladiators team has got to be considered one of the favorites. The recent winners of the Countdown Cup, their stats are phenomenal, they're peaking at the right time, trending ever upwards. They just look so scary. But like I said, there is history with this matchup before as well. Fusion against Gladiators actually was the match that started the 2020 playoffs. And that one, that was a clean 3-0 for the Philadelphia Fusion. But this is a very different squad. At least the Gladiators is a very different squad. And it's a familiar face coming back in. EQO subs in, but this time for Carpe. Carpe sits on the bench this time as they run with Shockwave EQO. They've done this a couple of times before when they like to go for heavy projectile or sometimes even double projectile, although sure, Shockwave is capable of playing hitscan for them too. I am very interested in seeing what kind of comps they have on the board because it's their map pick and they've chosen to take us to Anubis.
Anubis. I mean, the implications here could be all over the place. I believe it was a player on the Philadelphia Fusion. Was it Funny Asher that said the meta is very open?
Yes.
When he was talking about all of the players. And here's the leaderboard, though. Map leaderboard from this year. The Gladiators have set the fastest time on Temple of Anubis, by the way. And that's our map leaderboard presented by Xfinity. So the question remains, Fusion taking them to this map when they know the Gladiators are quite proficient at it. It could be...
It's confidence. It's a confidence pick.
It could also backfire.
It could. Certainly. It certainly could. The Gladiators have looked nasty good on Anubis all year long. Not even just that game where they set the record against Toronto, but they've just looked excellent at it in general. It leans heavily into Muse being able to play Winston-based comps. And they could also play Orisa via Orisa comps if the Fusion want to take things in that direction. I think this is... A questionable pick for sure, but I think the Fusion have got something special planned. The subbing in of EQO indicates to me that they've got plans for this map.
Yes, they do. Certainly. And I got to think as well, whenever I see EQO, I can't help but think of Genji. It's synonymous in my mind with it.
Yeah.
The Genji buffs, Josh. Listen, I want to put some energy out there into the world.
Okay.
Anubis.
Okay.
Possibly on the attack side.
Okay.
Maybe we might see it.
He has been playing a bit of Genji. He played it on Numbani during the Countdown Cup. I don't see it happening here. I don't want to burst your bubble,
you
Brent.
You never know.
I feel like... I am just interested, generally speaking, to see what they end up playing.
Sure.
EQO has been their Sombra pick, so perhaps they go in that kind of direction too once they scout things out. But they're going to start on defense, and they're kind of locked into this composition to start. The Tracer, Echo. It's pretty aggressive. You need to take the fight to the Gladiators here. And the Gladiators on attack can kind of set the tempo. They can choose to have Muse take more damage. That's going to farm up Shu's Nano. That's what you're expecting to be this big engage. Shu should be able to outpace Alarm when it comes to his Nano Boost charge.
We'll see how they do it. As you said, Josh, the Fusion, it's them that needs to take the fight right to them, up close and personal. They need to get an early lead somehow here. Nice team fight win early on. Sets them up nicely with the ultimate. Bionade right up the top. Is going to be a connection. Got to keep the players alive, though. That's a hack. Shockwave locked down onto the floor. Could not fly away. Nice setup there from Bird. We're going to get the default hack. And now it's the Gladiators pushing ever so forward. Big Bionade to try and set up this as well. Kev's are just going to be zipping back out of there to safety. Pops the recall just in case. But it is a clean team fight.
This is part of what makes the Gladiators so dangerous. You know that they're aggressive, and you know they have the win condition coming online of Shu's Nano. He was 20-25% ahead of Alarm. So you try and make a play. You try and hold aggressively with Mano, with Shockwave. And then just a moment of weakness, one small mistake, and Birdring finds the opportunity to get that hack. And suddenly, Scoots in your face. You're on the low ground. Space is harassing you. And it all falls apart from there.
It's really hard to try and get that kind of value out.
Here's where we need to see aggression on defense. Alarm has bought enough time to be able to get his Nano online. You normally see the Tracer, the Winston, coordinate some level of aggression, but they've allowed time for Muse to be the initiator.
He's already in. In fact, he's split up the line of sight there. Shu
It's getting pressured pretty heavily there, but Alarm right around the corner. Did eventually get that nano boost off onto Mano. It's a fading away. The Primal Rage built up as well. Still, an even fight. Unless Muse can perhaps turn it around with some absolutely ridiculously sickening plays. The mechanics are clean. Slipped up in the process, and it's coordination from them to try and shut
really
this one
well
down. Kevster, look at the tracking on that. Almost just takes him out in the spawn door. Shockwave struggling to get back into this fight. But the players are now coming back online still.
No way.
This one might not even matter. EQO, he's gone already.
This is the kind of fight where the Gladiators lost players early on, and you weren't expecting them to commit into it. That EMP is huge, and they're managing to take down Shockwave. Mana Pot Primal, but can't really get too much value out of it. But with Kevster dead, they're missing a lot of finishing power.
Yeah, they force out a rally from Funny Astro, though. There's one ultimate down, but it buys some time as well. They're going to be able to get their players back into this one. Defense going again.
And that's a little bit of stabilization. 4 minutes, 25 seconds on the clock for the Gladiators. They can push back in. It's an earlier nano available. EQO's positioning is fantastic. You always see the tracers playing from there on defense. It allows you great pulse bombs. You're able to blink around the side. You can get into the back lines very quickly. Shockwave continues to be the target, though. Hacked up again. Almost taken down, but gets the duplicate off.
Does indeed. Kevster in the back line there with that pulse bomb, but that's an answer. A fantastic one. EQO catching that one onto Shu, takes him out of the fight. The Nano Boost was expended, I should say. He was just trying to basically survive if he can get out of there. But it's a fusion, honestly, still staying in this one. Again, EQO, massive play trying to find that opening pick when Gladiators went for the engagement onto their own backline.
Yeah, EQO wins that fight for his team. There's a pulse bomb on the Shu. There's nothing you can do. If the Ana dies, that's the vast amount of your healing output when you're running Ana Brig comps. Now Alarm has another Nano. You'd normally expect the Fusion to be trying to play this one aggressive, and they do.
Yeah.
There's Mano off on the flank, takes the Nano Boost, but the Gladiators are already forging a path forwards.
Yeah, they push all the way forwards. In fact, Shockwave down again. Some nice dodging just around the pillar there from Shu, but not enough to survive. EQO hunts him down. A synergy is eventually there. Self-destruct across the point. It does force Gladiators now down to the low ground, but they still look like they want to fight this one. With Muse going down, though, it's looking less likely that they will. Switch up in momentum here from the Fusion. I don't think they got really the maximum value they were looking for out of that last Nano Boost, but it is even when it comes to those ultimates on either side.
Well, the big one that I'm looking at, though, is EMP. And obviously, there's nothing on the Fusion that could match that because they're not running a Sombra of their own.
Yeah.
So it comes down to Funny Astro to try and remove the value of Birdring's ult. If Astro can pop his rally at the same time or a little earlier, then Birdring possibly won't get the value he's looking for. The manual hack, though, if he
gets so much damage.
Hopper, that's a great start.
Yep, and now one less player. Stick around the corner there. I think that may have possibly connected. Alarm was so, so weak. Brought down to just nothing there, almost surviving it. But with Mano taken out now, the Gladiators, well, they're looking to get a bit of an edge into this team fight. The 1v1, Kevser versus EQO, just dodging, juking, trying to dodge around the corner, but not able to escape it at the end of the day. A big Bionade right into it. Muse, empowered now by the Nano Boost as well. He's leading the charge for the rest of his team. Slept up for but a moment, but again, woken up, and now he's built up this Primal Rage. This fight, it might be going into the direction of the Gladiators, but it is so drawn out.
Skewed with a clutch rally as well, keeps himself alive on less than 20 health, is now back up in the fight, providing rally armor to the rest of the Gladiators, making this one winnable. But Mano's got something to say about that, dives into the back line with his primal, and this fight continues to ever so slowly go the way of the Fusion.
Space almost getting value out of that one, but again, EQO just pulling things into his own hands. He's right into the back line, and Shu is missing. This has to be the disengage now from the Gladiators. They're all so weak, they can't afford to lose anybody else, and the Gladiators unable to finish it up here, not even getting a single tick on the board. The Fusion, impeccable stuff.
It really is a phenomenal defense. And now they're going to get double support ultimate online. The Gladiators were thinking about moving to a Reinhardt-based comp, which would have been extremely strange. But Muse sticks to the Winston, Kevster, in fact, being the one to make the adjustment. So they're anticipating aggression coming out of Mano. They know he doesn't have Primal, so the attempt here is to burst down the nano-boosted Winston with those Hellfire shotguns. It's doable,
lie,
but the Fusion has so many ults, and EQO has been a menace. Look at Kevster, though. He rolls him.
Right into the back. Mano taken out. EQO forced to use that rally. This time, they are way more aware. EQO has been the saving grace for the Fusion on these defenses with a lot of his pulse bomb kills. He drops it down right at the choke point, but it just forces out the Nano Boost. Muse, healthy again. Waiting for the leap engage onto the correct target. Does jump onto Funny Astro there, but it just forces out the rally. Now the fight continues, though, into the back. Muse taken out from that self-destruct, up close and personal, right at the back end there of Anubis. With both of them down, this is again the Fusion holding on, weathering this storm. The Gladiators coming up now with so much pace, forcing out these ultimates because they know it's their last chance.
This is less than 10 seconds on the clock, so Skewed has to go for the rally. But there's no Lucio, how's he even going to get there? Space with a desperate attempt to touch this objective.
Pushed away, the bash, Funny Astro. This guy is just elite, honestly. The Fusion, complete respect as well to this backline. They're only going to be looking at better and better. And it seemed like the Gladiators, they started that off with so much pace. They captured checkpoint A with essentially all the time in the world. But they just couldn't quite convert it into anything at all.
Yeah, that is a sizable time bank that has disappeared. And like you said, Brent, it's nothing at all. It's not just a good defense. They didn't take a tick.
Not a single tick.
Not anything. And so now the win condition for Fusion is extremely attainable.
I mean, it's so good.
It's almost impossible that you see a point A defense. I think we might have only seen one of them all season. Yeah, feel free to fact check me on that one. I'm sure I'm forgetting a couple. But point B, you normally have to give one tick over the course of the defense.
Yeah.
And yet the Fusion held completely solid. There was not a single time in which their aggression and their ult cycling offered any opportunity for a counterattack.
We have our live Overwatch pick'ems there, live.overwatchleague.com. You can participate in this trivia. What team won the first official Owl Reverse sweep on January the 18th, 2017?
You know, I really shouldn't give any hints to people who are participating, but I can't anyway, because I don't know.
Well, yeah, I mean, January 18th, 2017, I don't think the Overwatch League existed. So, I don't know.
Sure.
But if that is 2018, then I think the answer might be... I'm not going to give any hints. I'm not giving any hints, don't worry.
Okay, take a look at this, though. This is why EQO is in. So far, we've only really seen him playing the Tracer, but now he's playing Sombra on attack. That's his role for the Philadelphia Fusion. And again, like I described the first time around, the Fusion are just going to try and take some slow amounts of space and feed along the Nana Boost. That's their primary engage tool, unless one team gets a hack.
Gladiators are going to need a miracle to try and stop them here. A pick, potentially onto Shockwave again. They've been putting so much pressure on Shockwave, honestly, with a lot of these neutral hacks. It's a big Bionade sent in. Doesn't connect onto anybody, though.
They're actually not doing a very good job of going for soft engages and feeding Alarm. Now Mano goes for it. That's going to help Alarm take the lead in terms of Nana Boost charge, and Hopper takes a lot of damage, too.
Murdering.
And here we go. This could be the engage.
Yeah, they're still trying to build up this Nana Boost. And they're going to let this one rip. Finally, it goes through. The heals into the back and the collapse. Space demeched. Collapsed on two as well. Mano was hacked up, so he actually can do too much to sleep dart. Okay, well, there you go. Mano sleeping on the job there. An opportunity maybe for the Gladiators to come back in, but with the picks they're getting, looks very unlikely. For the Gladiators, a good sign for them is that they did hold on to this Nana Boost, but they had to give this one up. It looks like they might be going for a re-engage. You've got to be kidding me.
I mean, they definitely could. They have double support ultimate. If they can get a Nano onto Muse, he has the tankiness to be able to fight this. What you're looking into, though,
sleeping.
EQO has ult, and there he goes with it.
They connects! Birdrun was sleeping! He was the one target they needed, and they just burst him down. The re-engage comes through. The ultimates are committed. The Gladiators, that's Rally and Nana Boost into this one, and it just does not look winnable unless they get a bit more. Mano forced back, but he's going to get that mega health back, and already the kills just flooding in the direction of the Fusion.
And the Fusion have got this one for relatively cheap as well. The Gladiators could be happy that they got the EMP out, but look at the difference in terms of support ultimates. Shu and Skewed, like you said, Brent, both use theirs, and now the Fusion can attack with a Nano onto... I mean, you could even use this onto Shockwave if you wanted to, but I think it's going to go onto Mano. But you have a duplicate and a rally. They're going to be tanky with a lot of offensive pressure here.
Gladiators need to pull out everything. They jump onto the back line. Kevster uses the duplicate just to try and stave off all of this pressure coming their way. The ultimate's coming through there. This is Funny Astro using that rally. Hopper, okay. Sends it straight through. That's a self-destruct that actually did kill Muse there. Not too bad for them. In fact, Kips has gone down as well. Now, a quick little re-engage. Almost getting that tick on the board. The Fusion so close now to the finish line, and that's it. They only just had a few percentage points to gain. That is going to be them taking away Anubis. Clean and clinical gameplay from them. Fantastic work.
Smiles all around, especially from Alarm and Funny Astro, as the Fusion take a dominant map to tie this one up at 1-1. We doubted them. We thought it might be a bit of hubris taking the Gladiators to Anubis, but the Fusion knew what they were doing. That defense of point B was the game winner. Yeah. Denying the Gladiators even a single tick when they're one of the best offensive teams in the world on Anubis. This means we've got a game on our hands, Brent.
I mean, you've got to give credit as well to EQO, Funny Astro, those guys on the defense. EQO, the amount of times he was getting the picks of the pulse bombs.
Yeah.
Funny Astro denying a lot of the engagements that was coming in into their direction. And this is where they prove, really, that they can go toe-to-toe with one of the best teams in the league right now. And the Gladiators, they were all smiles. Now it's getting a little bit more stern as well. They can feel the heat rising. We're going to be going to a short break. And on the other side of things, of course, well, the series is going to be continuing. You don't want to miss it.
The Overwatch League is brought to you by the University of Hawaii at Manoa. Go to takemetomanoa.org today. We'll be right back.
We're dropping some serious loot for Grand Finals this year. Be sure to tune in to the Watchpoint pre-show on September 25th at 4:45 Pacific to earn the exclusive Grand Finals spray, 6 Overwatch League skins, and 100 League tokens. You know you're not going to want to miss that one at all. In fact, as well as that, on the Grand Finals, you get to watch, the show match as well, the Overwatch 2 show match that we've got going on.
Yeah.
That is going to be tasty.
That's
going
to be incredible. I'm so excited to see that. But I can tell you this, Brent, the players are not going to be as excited to play in that show match as they are to be playing in the finals. That's what they're all here for.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're all here to make sure they get that ticket to the Grand Finals of Overwatch League 2021 season. And the Gladiators, I think if you had asked most people who the favorites were in this tournament heading into day one, I think the two most popular options would probably be the Shanghai Dragons and the Gladiators. The prior because they've been the best team in 2021, and the latter because they're peaking at an incredible time right now, before playoffs. But they are 1-1 in this series. It has not gone easily for them. They got taken to home territory, honestly, when it comes to Anubis, and beaten fairly solidly. So now it's their choice in terms of maps, and we're going to King's Row.
Really are, yeah. And I wonder what we're going to be seeing. Both of these teams, no strangers to chopping and changing the compositions that they've been playing as well, adapting to one another, is what we've seen here. I think from that last map as well, it really did showcase that the Fusion are not going to go down easily. That first map got me a bit scared, honestly, that we might be looking at a bit of a one-sided affair between both of these squads, with the Gladiators just looking way too comfortable and confident on those compositions when it comes to working with the tanks and the DPS line. But thankfully, Fusion answered back, so we do have a closer series on our hands.
And absolutely, with teams that are as flexible as Fusion and Gladiators, there are going to be some comps that one team is better at and some comps that the other team is better at. And you don't really know until you get in the server and battle test it. So the first map, we saw the Gladiators look to be significantly better at the ball comps. And then Fusion come out playing mostly Winston stuff and are able to execute incredibly well with the Winston Ana, with Alarm on that crucial Ana role. Now we're seeing the Fusion defending with their Orisa comps. And not just Orisa, but the double shield, which wasn't available for them in the Countdown Cup because Sigma was banned in the hero pools. This is something that Philly have been doing quite a bit. During the play-ins, it was also something they relied on quite a lot, and they looked fierce on it. See if it's able to hold up against what the Gladiators come out here with.
And the Gladiators can also always change up a lot of their compositions. You can see they're just trying to get an early pickoff here with Kessler on the Widowmaker. They might, I don't think they're going to be opting into this double sniper. It's probably just to try and get the early picks, but probably going to be keeping the Hanzo for a bit of shield break and pressure. And they're going to be matching the double shield, interestingly enough. This is going to prompt the Fusion to actually drop down to the low ground, actually, and take this fight close up close and personal between them.
They need to try and get value out of the break. If you hold from long sight lines, Skewed's additional poke damage is going to be too much for Mano Shield to deal with, especially considering they have a Hanzo. So the longer and slower the Gladiators can force this fight, the better it's going to be for them. For Fusion, they really want to try and get crucial hacks and go for big engagements.
Yeah, it's a game of positioning. They actually rotate around. Gladiators have found a bit of a foothold onto the point, so they're starting to pressure the objective up, and Kevster with that pick onto Shockwave, pushing and pulling them every single direction. Kevster's just getting away with murder. No one's really putting the pressure onto him. Finally, though, that shield bash not enough. Can't coordinate to get the pick. Recall comes through anyway. That's going to be the poor swim, and that's a freebie for them. Kevster, what a play and setup.
That's so nice from Kevster. Using the recall to engage, to get closer to his opponents. Just keeping his positioning in mind over the last few seconds. And Birdring throughout all of that time was on an off angle, pumping in damage. This is how this first kill happened. All headshots from the high ground.
Oh my.
And the Gladiators comp just looks better right now. They have the extra poke damage from the Zen. They have the Discord orb to finish targets. And then Kevster on Tracer is going to be able to do more than EQO playing Sombra or honestly Reaper as well. The Fusion are really going for a comp that wants to hard engage into the Gladiators right now. It might not feel like it, but with the Reaper and the Brig, that is definitely the style they want. Close the gap, take the power away from the Hanzo and the Zen.
The Gladiators are kind of scouting the positioning very early on for the Fusion. Kevster in the backline again.
Distractions.
Yep. It does force out the recall. That's the Amp Matrix pushing them out of the line of sight. Fusion have to respect that. They back off for the time being. Still, EQ up onto the high ground, very low, has to wait for a bit of healing going his direction. He does get it in the end, and there's the Animatrix assisting with that pick. Shockwave takes out Birdring, Skewed falls as well, and finally you see the Fusion at least getting a team fight on the board.
Yep, very nice stuff. That's the pick coming out from their Ashe player, and they're able to convert the rest of the fight. Still 4 minutes on the clock, though, and huge ultimates for the Gladiators to be able to work around. They're going to be slightly faster to big ults like the Supercharger and the Gravitic Flux, but the Fusion aren't that far away either. And after a little bit of spam is exchanged, you're going to expect Mano and Hopper to be able to respond with ults of their own. I'm particularly looking at Kevster. A halt into a pulse, or even a Gravitic Flux into a pulse bomb, could lead to an advantage that the Fusion are not prepared to counter.
Sure. Halt into the Dragon Strike even as well.
Yeah, they have so many options, obviously.
A lot of options, yeah.
Yeah, these comps are great because the Orisa Halt gives you so many different win conditions.
Oh, this is sly. EQ spots it though, potentially hearing those footsteps. Ultimates were pulled out of them. Space ended up using that Gravitic Flux, but did not get the pickoff that they were looking for. No setup online, Kevster.
But they did force out Supercharger here, actually.
What is Kevster that? Gets the pick on the Shockwave. Shockwave just seemingly unaware of what was happening. Just kind of taken down already. 100-0, it seems. Now, Birdring straight up into the sky again. Going to be kept up with the healing of Skew to that Transcendence. They need to try and dislodge away Hopper, who's just sitting up onto that high ground. They've managed to separate him from the rest of his team. Could be an easy pickoff for them. It looks like they're already winning the team fight anyway, just from the look of the kill feed. And they can start to steadily push this card even further.
So far, so good on the offense for the Gladiators. Fusion have come up with a couple of moments where they've stalled them out, but now Funny Astro feels forced onto the Zen. They need that additional poke pressure from the backline. The problem with Funny Astro doing this is it's a very greedy setup that can get punished by Kevster's Tracer. Now that there's no Brig there to stop the Tracer, Kevster should be able to get more value. And when you've got a player of that caliber, it's always dangerous to not have the Brig. This backline has just been torn to pieces for Philly.
Yeah, they set up the dive approach. Birdring at the off angle. Headshots for days. Probably just laying them in from the high ground, if I was to assume. And it has set them up, honestly, for an easy win condition into this one. The ultimates are being pulled out at a Fusion, but honestly, not in ideal situations for it. Still, they get the pick onto Shooter Halt into Bob's line of sight. Potentially getting something out of that one, but no, taken out. Now EQO has to try and turn it around. It's
that
a good
huge.
Death Blossom. It gets two picks, and they're following up even more. Kevster desperate to try and turn this around, but the Fusion, well, this close to the spawn door, going to be getting the players back in time to really just stop them short.
Yeah, that was an amazing Death Blossom, actually. Didn't get to see it from EQO's perspective, but he did tons of damage
teleport
to the
up
tanks.
There, I think.
Yeah, really, really fantastic reposition, but he's going to move over to the Hanzo. This is a pick as old as time when it comes to EQO. He's been fantastic on it in the past, but now he's got to go toe-to-toe against Birdring. Just glimmers of the 2018 Grand Finals matchup between these two, both playing Orisa sniper comps. There's Kevster trying to have his impact in the fight, but Hopper gets healed up straight after that pulse.
Oh, a bit of pressure being applied. What a halt. EQO straight. The arrow flies, and that's a kill on the shoe. It's magic for them, but Birdring answers back with that one. Gravitic Flux into it. All the kills flowing in the direction of the Gladiators, despite that fantastic early advantage that was to be gained. And now the Gladiators, they've got so many opportunities now. It is just inevitable that this card ends up finding the target right at the end of King's Row here. That's going to be 2 minutes and 8 seconds on the board here for the Gladiators. That's what they set in terms of pace. Magical start.
There were a few glimmers of hope from the Fusion. Shockwave got a pick on the Ashe.
Yep.
There was a decent Death Blossom, and then that halt into a kill. Other than that, that map, or at least the first half of it, was very firmly in favor of LA.
Yeah.
They dominated the pace. They had all of the set plays. Kevster was a menace in the back line. And Funny Astro was playing Mystery Heroes in terms of cycling his role to try and adjust and find an effective counter. He ended up playing Mercy towards the end there and just got caught in the Gravitic Flux and the Dragon Strike and all of that pressure that was coming from the Gladiators. So far, so good. Very happy to match the Orisa v Orisa, and looked good with it. That's one of the biggest reasons that they were able to win the Countdown Cup.
Yeah.
Was the flexibility of Skewed going over to that Zen and applying so much offensive pressure.
Oh, this is the coordination. I mean, the damage is on Shockwave, and he's just trying to avoid it, but he just doesn't know where they are. Yeah, Birdring the entire time, just threading the needle with these. Waits for the teleport. quick and easy kill. That's how it happens.
So good.
Yeah.
Birdring's on a different level when it comes to these kind of playoff games. He's been excellent for them all season long, but during that Countdown Cup run, and now in this match as well, when he's able to play the Hanzo, he's outclassing the DPS from the Fusion.
And now, how do you match this pace if you're the Fusion on their attack side? They're going to still keep running this composition here with the backline, but EQO on the Genji. Here we go!
It has been buffed recently.
It has.
But, I mean, the Shuriken damage does allow him to be a little bit more of a brawler. It's a very brawly composition. They've got the Genji, they've got the Brig. They want to take the fight to the Gladiators and get probably deep onto that backline.
A power drive engage, though. Muse is doing a fantastic job of just disrupting them up here, changing up the pace. When the Fusion are trying to take map control as well, moving around as well without taking too much damage, it's Muse there coordinating with the DPS to find it. EQO does get one, gets two as well. His mechanics never in question when it comes to this roll. Might even get a third if he's lucky. No, the peel is there in the end. If he can try and get out alive, though, it'll be excellent for the Fusion to come back into this one with a bit of an advantage, but T-Mech onto Hopper is not ideal.
It's absolutely brutal, because now that buys time for Shu and Skew to get back in the fight. And sure, your Genji picked the backline, but you'd already lost the team fight before that. The pile drive from Muse, everyone getting slowed down. The pick on space, though, is great to start this team fight off. The Gladiators need to play a little slow.
Yeah, they're still going to be trying to work their way in here. Birdring ended up using that Dragon Strike. Too sure where ended up going here. Kevstar with the Pulse Bomb. That's going to be a nice stick. Shockwave taken out. The Gladiators on the defense are looking pretty primed now to take this, especially with the Mines doing all the work. Two kills for them. Rolling straight through. Beat down into the back line. A coordination is absolutely there.
Yeah, this is phenomenal play from the Gladiators. You think about how these two team comps want to match up, and as long as the Gladiators buy time with their tanks, they have the pressure to be able to kill them. Birdring's eventually going to get a pick or enough damage. The same can be said for Shu from long range, and then Kevstar's constantly applying pressure from an off angle. They've already used the nano in the previous engagement too, so once this blade comes online for EQO, it's just going to be raw. Ugh, it's so hard to get value in that situation. Oh, and he takes a big headshot too. He has to back off with the rest of his team.
Yeah, he's going to get a rally armor, but that power drive again, it's just going to be stopping him short. He's trying to build up this ult, but he's finding it so difficult. Tries to go for the dash engage, doesn't have it now for his next team fight. He's tried to use it to catch Kevstar, who's in the back line, but just evading him the entire time. EQO with his attention split, not able to get too much done. A halt into the dash again, uses the blade in the end, but look at what he's doing it into. It's so hard to even get a single kill with the rally online, but the ultimates are combined. That's going to be the self-destruct as well as the Bob sent in. They do get a few pickoffs, and they're slowly edging this fight out.
Yeah, all of this pressure just bursted through the middle of the Gladiators, drew so much attention, and in some sense, EQO's blade made space for the tanks. It's the opposite way around to what you would expect, but that's about the best value you could get from a dry dragon blade.
Yeah, just into pulling the rally.
Yeah, pulling the backline and Birdring's attention, making space for your tanks to take position on the point, and they can then finish out the team fight. It's still a relatively good time back, actually, 3 minutes and 20 seconds, but the Fusion don't look like they have replicable success. Things will get easier for their Orisa-based comp during the Streets phase, though.
See how they find the timing with EQO on the Sombra. Scout out of it in position. Just needs to be careful he doesn't get pre-fire. Tries to get the tracking down, but look at that peel. Space, very aware, immediately turns around and pressures them off. Now we wait for Muse to see if he can get this power drive. Into the mines as well, drops it right down. That's Shudo taken down early. I think that was a halt into Shockwave, putting in a bunch of that damage. Nano Boost is applied later on top of it, and one quick headshot, more than enough. The pressure is on when you get a Nano Boost put onto you as a DPS player, but certainly delivering for now.
Yeah, Shockwave a little slow to start in this series, I would say, over the course of the first two maps, but he is coming alive right now. Just helping, or rather, getting assistance from Mano. These halts are great to combo with Dynamite to give him easy headshots. And now as EQO changes composition again, he moves his hero over to Hanzo. They're going to be able to provide double off-angle pressure from these snipers.
Okay. Well, that's the Supercharger drop down and the Dragon Strike to split them up. It's a bit of damage onto it, but not enough. They get zoned out by the Supercharger. The Dragon is wasted.
Mano's looking around for his opponents like, surely they were here, right? Surely they were holding close, looking to defend. And yet, no, the Gladiators were miles away. Just playing off the fact that they've got extra poke damage coming from that Zen. It's only really Kevstar that's close.
OK,
Gonna try and coordinate something. Kevster, though, he's used his recoil early. Nothing to escape it, but luckily the team is there. Shu just firing shot after shot, following up on the work that the team's doing. Nice and easy kills. And they do stop them from getting too much done as well. The cart's got progress, though. 3 minutes online. The fusion coming up on a bit of ultimates here. Shockwave of a late delayed kill, though, or that death, I should say, is not ideal for the fusion here. They're going to be staggered in this next team fight.
Yeah, and their positions are pretty good. They've got Kevster in a nice place where he can maybe look for an early pulse bomb. And honestly, I mean, let's take a look at the replay from Shu's point of view. Just interesting to note, usually when they run double flex support, Shu is the one that's playing Batiste. The Gladiators are getting so much work done here. They got a pulse bomb out from Kevster, Bird Ring with another pick. You look at the ults coming online as well. The Gladiators are massively favored here. They have the Gravitic Flux. That's going to get you more consistent value than Hopper's self-destruct. And Kevster's just harassing them, stopping them from leaving their spawn.
They look a little bit lost here. The fusion, I mean, they're confusing even our observers. They were just waiting back. They were like, surely the fusion are going to be able to get in here. But they're chopping and changing. The engagement is never quite orchestrated directly there. The halt into that self-destruct. It's good, but the immortality keeps them all alive. The fusion might be forced to invest ultimates just to get past the choke point. Halt into the Gravitic Flux. It's massive. So much damage being done, but again, the immortality field is there. It's going to be keeping them still alive for now.
They committed the trance
into this,
though.
Transcendence as well. The fusion investing, but not getting any returns.
Yeah, the Gladiators just forged forwards there with Shu's trance, continuing to try and follow up on that Gravitic Flux, despite the fact that the Funny Astral got out, Alarm, I think it was at the time, got out a really nice immortality field. And now you see Alarm move to Zen, Funny Astro on the BAP, and the Philly Fusion are going to try and match this pressure. But in all of this ult cycling, Muse has now built up a supercharger, and the Fusion again are just going to have to disengage or die.
Oh my, Hopper's taken out.
They choose to die.
You just can't do anything. I mean, the arrow's just flying straight. Alarm taken out.
This is now their opportunity to go forwards, though. The Gladiator's ult cycle has finally stopped. And plus, with that kill on Kevster, the fusion can start to move forwards, or at least they could have done if Mano stayed alive. They can use the Dragon Strike to take space.
Even if the fusion end up pushing this right now, it's highly likely this ends up being an overtime push.
Can you even complete
I don't know if you can complete with time. This might just be a write-off from this point on. The Gladiator's job is done. This forward hold is brutal. They have shaved off so much time.
Kevster's playing Genji as well. Feels like a slap in the face. EQO can do it, I can do it even better.
Dragon Strike in a high ground position? I don't think anybody's there. I think anticipating that Space might have been playing a bit further back, but it just doesn't catch him. Kevster taken out, pushing forwards though. Now the Transcendence is pulled out of them. The Gladiators now have got the healing necessary to push this one forwards and the picks. The Shockwave gets taken out once more. Hopper just desperate to try and build up this Gravitic Flux now into the final 9 seconds left, but they are just toppling over, and it is despair on their faces. Space looking so determined.
The Gladiators are crushing them.
Yep.
That is a dominant point C defense, the likes of which I've never seen before on King's Row. That was, what, 2-3 minutes of just holding them in the spawn.
Yep.
The aggression from the Gladiators and their coordination, the positions they take. That's got to be demoralizing for Philly.
They're going to be hunting for a way back into this one off the back of that. I mean, as well as that, the mental resilience, I think, from Gladiators to then, you know, lose Anubis in the way that they did, getting full held in that fashion, and then immediately bouncing back. King's Row coming through with a really, really solid hold. Compositional as well. I mean, it felt like a bit of comp diff coming out from that series as well. The backline was just having an absolute field day on the Gladiator side of things. They're going to be getting up out of their seats discussing exactly what they want to do next. And the series is by no means over, obviously. The Fusion are going to get their opportunity to try and pick the next map.
And so far, map picks have equaled map wins. The Gladiators is the higher seed, managed to take the first one. A good response from the Fusion, now a good response from the Gladiators. If this continues, we could be seeing a series that goes down to the wire. Which is the team that's going to flip the momentum in their favor? If you manage to win on your opponent's map pick, that's a great boost, not only in terms of your morale, but you also break that flip-flopping of maps from one side to the next. It's the Fusion's map choice coming up. I don't have a good read on these teams, though. They're so flexible,
yeah.
I don't know where they would want to go. The set styles don't really apply to these guys.
really is up in the air here. We're going to go to a quick break, and on the other side of things, of course, the series is going to be continuing. We're going to pray and hope that the Fusion can be making it a bit more competitive than that we just witnessed. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
Coca-Cola is the official refreshment of the Overwatch League.
Support. It's true.
it's on the high ground. What do they do here? Shu has taken so much damage. He's been pushed down to the low ground. And the aggression is just enough. That's going to be Havana going to the Gladiators. And we are going the distance here. Shu, what is that?
That is so good from Shu. What a beast in the back line.
Wait, wait. They're getting pushed off the point. It's still winnable for the Gladiators.
They certainly are.
He can be... He can get slapped. Oh. It doesn't even come out. The Gladiators are coming back on the point. No way.
This is huge. And the Gladiators squeak over the line.
That's how you get those insane statistics.
Shu is just absolutely insane.
Oh, he gets shut down. Shu finds it, Nero. He's in shock.
What a brilliant performance from our MVP candidate here.
Take a sip of your milk or whatever that was. You deserve it. And what's going through my head over and over is that Ant Matrix play from Shu. What a individual clutch.
It's going to be desperation now for the Gladiators.
Shu's turning it with his Ant Matrix.
With the Ant Matrix
Shu.
On the back. Jinmu's been taken out. I don't believe that. You have got to be kidding me.
Now, Shu's been putting up a bit of a Giga Chad performance so far in this series. This backline of the Gladiators, I mean, we knew that this matchup between these two teams was going to be so hotly contested based off the back of, you know, the performances that we've seen from both of these teams' backlines. But the Gladiators, definitely, it's been a key win condition for them, especially in the Countdown Cup and leading into this now, where they've been able to just output so much pressure when it comes to the damage and different double flex support compositions.
Yeah, I think both of the biggest matchup when you look on paper of the Fusion against the Gladiators is their backline, in my opinion. I mean, You start with Alarm Shu, and you're immediately your thoughts are, oh my word, what a treat we've got coming up. Mm-hmm. Because the battle of them playing Zen, them playing Bap, them playing Ana, whatever they go to, they're two of the top three flex supports in the world when they're able to play at their peak. They are elite, elite tier players. And then the support that comes from them, or rather the support they get from their partner, be it Funny Astro, be it Skewed or Moth, is world class as well. I think overall, though, my biggest takeaway from this match so far has been the impact that the DPS players have been able to get. And here we see Carpe coming in for EQO. EQO is definitely their Swiss Army knife, can play whatever for them.
Yeah.
And he was great on the Tracer when it came to Anubis. They've also brought in Rascal.
Rascal.
Here we go.
Okay.
I didn't think we'd be seeing Rascal getting playtime, to be honest. I thought we'd just have the rotation of Carpe, EQO, Shockwave. But this is very exciting to me. We're heading into Havana. It's the map pick of the Philadelphia Fusion. What have they got up their sleeve?
Yeah, I want to see something naughty cooked up, I think, from the Philadelphia Fusion. I mean, I'm just excited, man. We've been seeing it, Josh. You were saying the trends of this have been leaning towards the teams that picked the maps. When Anubis is picked by Philly, they end up winning it. When King's Row is picked by Gladiators, they end up winning it back and forth. Eventually, one of these teams is going to have to break that. Unless it's the Gladiators and taking it in five, in which case they might. It's the possibility still there. But Havana will be the stage of which we're going to be seeing it really play out. And probably going to be seeing very different looks from both of these teams, I imagine, compared to what we saw in that first match. And you can already tell, I mean, the stylistic differences between them are just night and day.
Yeah, compared to the first match, absolutely. I mean, of these teams, which one is more likely to run the Reinhardt Rush comps? Definitely the Philadelphia Fusion. They think of themselves as being truly versatile. They can play any comps that they want to play. I think the thought process from these Philly players is that they are good enough to execute whatever they think is best on the map.
Yeah.
So they're not really going to play to their strengths. They're going to try and play to what they perceive to be the meta or whatever suits the map the best, etc., etc. And a lot of teams have done a lot of theory crafting about how to play this map, and we've ended up with rush defenses being the most common. Are the Gladiators likely to match that with Skewed in the lineup instead of Moth? I don't think we're going to see Lucio Rush coming out from the Gladiators today, but maybe some kind of sim variant.
Yeah, kind of all over the place, honestly, with this composition. Setting up the power drive.
Genji Tracer dive!
Genji Tracer dive. Skewed though, frozen up, locked up. Rascal gets the kill. There's the Fusion winning this one out. The trouble with this dive comp from the Gladiators is you need to lock down one target. We see a pause being asked for there as well, and that's coming from the Fusion side of things. So they win out the first team fight, and they get a bit of a pause as they sort out one of their issues that they might have.
Yep. And already we can see, I mean, potentially part of the reason why Rascal's been brought in, right? He's an amazing Mei player.
Yeah.
He's excellent at being able to read the tempo of the game, find targets, use his Mei walls to isolate people too. And the Gladiators' response is really interesting. I think these two teams are quite similar in terms of their style. Are liking to play a lot of the Ball's End comps. They like to play the Orisa comps as well. But one of the big differences really is how little the Gladiators have played Reinhardt over the course of this season. And even if you think back to the main melee where it was more meta, like the most meta that Reinhardt comps have been, I would say it was in the main melee. That was where the Gladiators looked weakest. Mm-hmm. I think most people would say that's because they were a young team and that was when they first were getting their coordination built together, but it might have something to do with the comps as well. We are back live though, and the Gladiators have started to make some shifts. Birdring, instead of going for the Genji Tracer setup, they're going for Hanzo,
okay,
as Chu and Skewed play Bap Zen in the back line.
Yeah, and Birdring, okay, making a switch again. Doomfist this time.
It doesn't look like they have a set strat.
Birdring kind of messed up the engage here. I'm not sure if he meant to bunny hop off the cart there with his punch, but gets frozen up onto the side. Kefs is taken out as well. That's Carpe with the big iron on his hip. Not letting Kefs to run away with it. Alarm taken out, though, will put a bit of a dampener on the Philadelphia Fusion. It looks like they are going to be winning this one out. Carpe just popping off. Flashbang not going to be connecting, but that's okay. Still can fire out the shots as well as that if he's kept alive. Hopper D-Mech, though.
They're still fighting this.
Skewed gets delayed. I mean, this is a bad stagger for the Gladiators. Despite their spawn door being quite close, they're still going to look to try and fight this now. But a Fusion, they could find their way back into this one. No, not going to be happening. Carpe, Mano, not able to withstand the pressure that was coming their way.
They only just found the timing to punish Fusion before Alarm got back, though. Alarm is the only player left alive in this team fight because he wasn't even there. He was coming back off the respawn. And normally you would expect Fusion to disengage. They want to go backwards, have Funny Astro taxi Alarm back from spawn, and kind of meet up for the second team fight. But instead, Fusion just commit heavily forwards, die on payload, contest the objective, and that's half the time bank already gone.
Yep, mine's up the top. Muse.
What is there to combo with?
Yeah, no setup with the Bap Driver. It pushes them out. The Deadeye being channeled up there. Muse almost goes down to it, in fact.
But they've delayed enough time so that the Fusion can't really rotate up top and stop this objective.
Okay, Mana going for the pin from downtown there. Did manage to lock them up. And they have bought a bit of time, Josh, as you were saying. Good self-destruct into the back. It's the immortality field taken out. Hopper drops his as well, but be taken out, so not going to be available in this fight. Big Earth Shadow online for Mano. Lets it drop, but that is going to be a bit of a miss. Just about. Skewed just jumping onto the car to a dodge and avoid that, sidestepping it in the process. And the Fusion just going to be toppling over from this one.
Yeah, Fusion looking a little uncoordinated as soon as the Gladiators threw a curveball at them. They didn't look prepared for Muse to play that aggressively, and we were caught off guard by it as well. But the Fusion then never really got in position to take a good team fight. Hopper Mars ahead of the rest of his team ended up being taken out of mech and dying, and then that just isolates Mano. Nothing he can really do without his off tank being there. The Fusion are going to stick on this rush comp, but Funny Astro moves to Brick, trying to shut down Kevstra a little more, perhaps. And Rascal's ultimate is going to be crucial for them here.
Yeah, Alarm on the Ana as well is very intriguing. A bit more win cons, I suppose, with the Bionades if they can land them here.
He's getting pressured right now.
Yeah, but exactly. And now they're missing the speed boost to really try and engage into this one as well with this Korn, but they can't disengage from the Dragon Strike. Gets sent then straight into the top left area. Tanks pressured out.
That is a phenomenal play by the Gladiators. The aggression from space pushes the back line inside that room. Then they hit them with the Dragon Strike, so that when they're in the room, they're taking a ton of damage. That forces their positioning backwards into Kevster. Just a gorgeously executed play from the Gladiators to push and pull the Fusion, never allow them time to set up their own play. And Rascal's still just holding onto this Blizzard, like, okay guys, I'm ready to use it, but he hasn't had an opportunity. He really also has to worry about space.
Yeah, and that's the high ground there. You see this AM Matrix drop down the window, pushes the Fusion all the way into the staircase, have to back all the way around the corner. With Funny Astro down, no more speed boost as well for this engage. Is anyone going to be able to touch this?
They have a Nano, and they have the Blizzard. They have the ults to be able to fight, but like you said, no Lucio. Did that get anyone? No, not quite. Carpe has a nano, and he's miles away from everyone.
Whoa, what? What's going on here? Taking a sweet time, eventually going to be jumping right up. Needs to coordinate something, though. Needs to take out this backline. Good freeze. The Blizzard is connecting. It's going to be the pickoff onto them as well, but this fight's still taking place onto the objective, the card. Hopper just trying to mark it, make sure that they can't just sneak it in as that team fight takes place. Regardless, the Gladiators are definitely edging this one out. The damage they've got is far superior when Birdering isn't really being dealt with as well. Just firing off those shots from afar. It feels like the Fusion have been scrambling for a while now, struggling to find an answer. And can you blame them when Birdering's hitting shots like that?
The Fusion, though, have not been able to actually pin Gladiators down. Gladiators' mobility playing this ball tracer kind of composition, they're applying a ton of pressure to the Fusion. And it's Philadelphia whose positioning is getting forced. They've caught out Funny Astro a couple of times in these engagements. They're also stopping Mano from being able to get onto them. And even Carpe, when he takes the nano, is just miles away from being... It's not a coordinated setup. He didn't have anyone else forcing the Gladiator backline into it.
That Mano's off the map.
Oh, that's
just sent straight off the map of the power driver. Kev's, I think he was thinking about alarms
gone
as well.
Oh, you can't be doing that. You can't be doing that. I was talking about the Gladiator's aggression forcing the positioning of the Fusion. I didn't mean forcing them off the edge. I just mean in terms of where they're taking the fights. Why are the Fusion taking the fights on the edge of the map anyway?
I don't know. This
is the kind of thing. The Fusion just feel like they can't take fights on their own tempo.
Oh, see ya.
There's no world in which the Fusion plan to take the fight there. But because of how the Gladiators are playing, they're forced to. They're getting booped down and booped off.
He didn't even shift his grapple hook. He's just going back and forth, back and forth. Anyway, Fusion now need to find something here. Ultimate's online.
It's a free shatter if Mano can get an opportunity onto somebody good.
Yeah, a lot of targets that he can hit it on here. They're going to try and coordinate something. Carpe in the back line. Might be feeling the pressure to try and perform right now. Possum sent out, but that's the immortality field to keep them alive, and no one's really dealing with this. How did Funny Astro just get taken out there? It was just a grapple roll straight through. They're going to get the D-Mech on top of it. The Fusion, I mean, they've just kind of toppled over ever since point B.
Yep, they're not in this fight. The Gladiators are storming forwards, a minute on the clock, and no value out of the self-destruct. A desperation beat from Funny Astro that only catches onto the supports. Rascal moves over to Genji. The Phil Fusion are not really in this. It's just Carpe trying to take on the world in the back line.
Oh, see you later. Yeah, Ankepsa just hunts you down. I mean, assisted by the Discord Orb, sure, but right now the Gladiators in complete control, and they have been since checkpoint B. There's been no real wholehearted attempt to try and stop them. The Fusion, I think, a bit disjointed in terms of the concepts and ideas they wanted to run with these compositions, I think, as well. A little bit all over the place with it. They are doing a good job of delaying. It's only for a couple of seconds there. The self-destruct will push them all away. And that's going to be 29 seconds on the board with a full completion on Havana.
Yeah, very messy stuff from the Fusion in terms of how they're taking these team fights. You can see the idea behind some of their, at least compositional swaps. Carpe's running the Tracer to try and apply pressure onto this greedy backline of the Zen Bap. But on his own, he can't do enough. He needed somebody else to coordinate with, and the timings that Carpe's going for are not synced up with the rest of his team. And without Carpe playing that damage-dealing role, the rest of the squad looks a little limp in terms of how they're taking the fights. They're just getting bullied, their positioning forced, bad engagements being taken. I think this short pause, this minute on the clock, is a good time for Philly to reassess how they're taking the fights, talk a little bit, communicate about how they're coordinating their engagements.
I mean, this is a replay all the way back from checkpoint B when Birdering was just collecting the kills.
And even in this instance, Brent, Hopper is isolated from the rest of his team. The rest of Philly wanted to take an aggressive fight with Carpe, with the Blizzard, for example. But Hopper just had to stay guarding the payload. And the Gladiators are mobile enough to run rings around.
Yeah. And it is, yeah, it feels like the Fusion getting caught up in the, you know, the hero select a little bit as well. When they were making these adaptations and trying to swap around just one or two players, you weaken, I guess, the tank line as a result of it.
And the Gladiators not opting for that rush defense that we've seen so far from the other three teams that have played today on Havana. So the Gladiators instead going for this Orisa. That's going to help the Fusion get out of spawn for sure. But again, they're going for a different backline setup. Alarm on Ana from the Astro on Brig. They don't have the same level of poke pressure that is instead coming from the Gladiators with that Bab Zen.
Yeah.
It's very brawly.
It's so brawly. And you get the extra damage boost, I guess, from the recent patch onto the Genji. You can try and get a bit of ult cycling going with the Nana Blades as well, but you need to get a good start. So far, Gladiator is just kiting them back. Slowly, surely. That high ground position. Okay, Holt into something, but not enough for the kill. In fact, Birdring takes out Carpe. Nice accretion, though. Skewed down. A lot of fusion now have at least a window of opportunity they could capitalize off of.
The problem is, the longer these teamfights take, the more Birdring becomes an offensive threat. He's just sending in arrows, and eventually he's going to get a pick. The law of average dictates it.
Oh, my goodness. No one marking Kev'Sa the entire time. He managed to just sneak his way into the back there. It's an easy pulse bomb setup.
He's causing chaos. He really is. And now he gets onto Carpe as well. Shu steals the final blow, but Kev'Sa is an absolute menace.
Yeah,
and there's no one really on the fusion that can match him. No one's got the mobility. I suppose you could try with Rascal, but a Genji is not favored in battles against a Tracer. Kev'Sa's going to tear you up every time. Plus, he's always got the Discord Orb to coordinate.
He's popping off. He's popping off. He's being enabled. The team is playing around him. And, I mean, you can feel the amount of pressure the fusion's under. Especially when the roles were flipped around, when they were playing on the defense as well, and Funny Astro was forced over to the Brig to try and find an answer for it. Right now, this is looking like just an absolute steamroll. The Gladiators are more than comfortable to be playing these compositions, and they've got the synergy on top of it to coordinate. As we've been saying, Kev'Sa and Skewed working together all the time to just find those one or two pickoffs.
Yeah, Rascal is still only at 70% of the blade here. So even if you're thinking about Nana Blade being the win condition,
it
ain't going to come up right now. And the Gladiators take the fight to them with this Ant Matrix, and they're just shredded. The Philadelphia Fusion's comp wants to brawl. It did even more earlier when they were running the Reaper, but it's not good enough. And this Nana onto Carpe finds no value.
He gets two, but is two really going to be enough? Fusion,
I don't think so.
Struggling here.
Also, Alarm used his nano in that fight onto Carpe, right? So that means that Rascal is now stuck.
Yeah, no nano blade.
To be fair, he could get value out of the supercharger, but the supercharger only grants you extra damage. It doesn't grant you extra defense, extra tankiness, bulkiness. Rascal could still just be destroyed at a moment's notice.
Here we go. Fusion. I'm going to try and get those two picks to waste, I suppose. Going to be trying to push this forwards now with a rally online. But the Gladiators, they come in with the ultimates of their own. Space going to be dodging that accretion. Doesn't want to get taken out of the Gravitic Flux animation. In fact, he's rewarded with a kill into Hopper regardless of it. The damage is just immense. How do you overcome this one here? And a supercharger, not even enough. It was committed into this fight, but nothing gained.
Yeah, Rascal really did need to find an opportunity with his blade in that fight. You have to use the blade when the supercharger and the rally are up. If you don't, what are you waiting for? Just a dry opportunity to try and blade in? The best you can do right now is force out Trance. That's your only option with this Genji. It's otherwise been a complete waste. The fusion can never close the distance, and that's part of the reason why Funny Astro has now gone Lucio.
Well, Carpe, speed boost forwards, okay. That's a nice little pick there onto Birdring. Potentially set the pace now. We're getting into overtime potentially now as well, but that pick onto Muse is also quite nice. Now, finally, the blade unleashed, forces out of Transcendence, but shut down anyway. That's Shu, the Discord Orb, just marking Rascal the entire time. No durability in place to keep him alive still. Carpe might be able to pull this from the precipice. He's finding the shots, and they're definitely getting the damage in now. The fusion? Just about. Just one more target they need to push away, and that's Muse, and they are going to be able to get this capture eventually.
As soon as Funny Astro goes to Lucio, suddenly their composition works again.
Yep.
They can close the distance against the Gladiators because they can take space before they get shredded from all of this poke damage. If you're slowly walking forwards, you give tons of time for Birdring, for Shu, for Space to just fill you with holes. Instead, add a Lucio speed boost into the mix, and suddenly Carpe and Rascal are in your face before you can do anything. They overwhelmed Muse, and the early pick on Birdring didn't hurt either. Now we've got a Nano on board, probably going to get used for Carpe. But into double shield, it's still going to be difficult.
Yeah, you'd have to imagine. How to get the value off. Alarm sends out a sleep, but not finding the one target he was hunting for. Just trying to find a way into this fight. Carpe, so far forward, that's a Nano who's forced out. They have to use it, otherwise Carpe is going to go down. Hopper falls as well. The Deadeye gets nothing. And the Gravitic Flux just shuts down everything to do with that fight.
they force out so many mistakes from the Fusion there. I mean, a tiny bit of aggression from the Gladiators on defense, and suddenly panic in the ranks of Philadelphia.
Yeah, Nanobush just chucked out.
Carpe realizes he's mispositioned. Alarm tries to save him with the nano. Carpe runs forward with Alarm to try and get any value out of the ults that they've used, and it's just chaos. Now there's a minute on the clock. Funny Astro with a beat. That's basically the only thing they have to work with here. The Gladiator's still running a comp that does a large amount of damage. Birdring v Carpe again.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And they've rotated all the way around. Positioning has been gained for them. Pulse bomb is good. It's going to be the sound barrier. Funny Astro just trying to keep his team alive. In the meantime, nice little stick there from Rascal. That's Birdring gone. This could be a turning point for them, but they need to deal with the Gladiators. This tank line is just so brawly with the Amp Matrix to play around as well. Look at the damage they're outputting. It's such a threat of both tankiness and the damage just coming their way, shredding them in the process.
The Philly Fusion's comps have been a bit of a mess
all over the place.
They really have. It feels like they're trying to make individual swaps to try and counter the Gladiators rather than full team compositional swaps. And they haven't tried to run the mirror at any point either and just skill it, which was always a Philadelphia Fusion special in the 2020 season when they looked so strong. Now they've got the ball, Mano with the mines. He's going to be able to get onto the payload and deny some space. Although it looks like he's not the one that's going to touch. It's actually Hopper.
Yeah, Hopper will touch. Mano comes in, but it's so much crowd control as well. Flashbang into the shield bash. Nobody touches the point. That is honestly a bit of a disappointing end to the Fusion in that map, I will say. It looks like they were very uncertain in terms of how they wanted to swap up their compositions the entire time. But for the Gladiators, listen, they can be very happy. They're moving forwards here. They're not going to get knocked down to the lower bracket. One step closer to that end goal that every team here is working towards. For the Fusion, it's not over just yet. Plenty of opportunities that they can battle back, but they're going to have to do it from the lower bracket.
And their next opponent looks scary because Fusion are going to be playing against either the Shock or the Shanghai Dragons. So things do not get easier for Philadelphia here. The Los Angeles Gladiators, though, they came out with a statement here today. Sure, they dropped Anubis, and the Philadelphia Fusion looked great there. But everywhere else, the Gladiators just simply outclassed them, looking phenomenal on King's Row, obliterated them with their double flex support comps on Havana, and then setting things off with great pace in their map one. The Gladiators looked like they haven't dropped a beat since winning the Countdown Cup. This match win streak continues. They're now up to 8 in a row.
Yeah, and a big part of why they were so successful has to go to our player of the match presented by Xfinity. The one, the only Kevster playing off the back of the rest of his team as well. The coordination was elite. I think map one, you really saw it showcased, I think, between the tank line and Kevster. But as it just get further and further into the series as well, you just see that the whole team is on the right page. When Kevster is just pushing and pulling them apart at every single point, getting these pickoffs out of nowhere, I mean, the guy is a menace on the battlefield.
Yeah, Kevster and Birdring both really turned up today, and I think that made the biggest difference in this match. Kevster's Tracer was a menace that the Philadelphia Fusion could never contain. They weren't trying to pull their Tracer. I mean, they didn't even run a Tracer a lot of the time, but when Carpe was running it, he didn't play in a passive manner trying to peel Kevster away. The Flash couldn't do anything to try and stop Kevster. He was just a beast. Look at that final blows per 10. Yeah. Nearly 12 final blows per 10 minutes.
2.5 deaths per 10 as
I mean, he just didn't get even contested. No. Never mind shut down. He was a freak. This squad is looking so good.
Yeah.
They are scarily excellent. And considering they're on the same side of the bracket as the other favorites, the Shanghai Dragons, that upper semis, if it plays out the way that people are expecting, and we do see Shanghai against Gladiators, what a treat. What an incredible treat. And Brent, we're not even over yet. I mean, this day is only half done.
Two more matches. Two more matches to be played on top of this one. I mean, at this point in the tournament as well for the Overwatch League playoffs, normally by this point you start to get a feel of who the heavy favorites are. So far, I mean, we've seen the Dallas Fuel pull out new looks and look really good. We've seen Gladiators looking incredible as well, playing all the stuff that they usually did. Like you said, haven't missed a beat since the Countdown Cup. And coming up, I mean, we've got even more matches that might be deciding some more heavy favorites as well. I mean, we don't know what's going to be happening. This tournament is crazy.
Yeah.
We have an interview with Kevster coming up as well, as we get to hear directly from his mouth what it was like to really just absolutely take over the server, and also a short break. But after that, of course, even more Overwatch League 2021 playoff action is going to be kicking off
in front of your screens, and you know you're not going to want to miss it.
The Overwatch League is brought to you by Xfinity, the preferred internet provider of the Overwatch League.
Welcome back to Game Break, everybody. I'm Danny Lim. I'm joined here by the player of the match, Mr. Kevster from Los Angeles Gladiators. Kevster, congratulations on the win.
Thank you.
Yeah, all right. Well, let's just get right into the questions. My first question is a very, very serious one, Kevster, and it's sort of a personal one. Mm-hmm. What do you have for breakfast?
Today, I ate Cane's.
Yeah, what did you have? What?
I ate Cane's. It's, I don't know, some restaurant. It's
oh,
good.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah, chicken. Yeah. All right, that's the secret, guys.
What? I didn't even know what that was.
Yes, chickens. You gotta have chickens for breakfast if you want to be as good as
amazing
Kevster. Oh my
god! That's all it takes.
I just wanted to ask because you were popping off today on that tracer, and it was such a joy to watch you just
thank
eliminating
you
everybody. So that was just a quick little fun question. Let's just I want to follow that up with an actual question. What were your thoughts on the Philadelphia Fusion before the match, and has your thought changed after playing the match with the Philadelphia Fusion?
I think coming into the match, we're really confident. I thought it was going to be an easy win, and it was, so not really much changed.
Didn't really change. You thought it was going to be easy, and it was easy for you and the Gladiators. Okay. Uh-huh. And also, from watching your games, I realized that you especially, you were on the Philadelphia Fusion's DPS Shockwave constantly, and up to a point where I felt sort of sorry for Shockwave, where he couldn't really play the game. Was that something that you and the team sort of talked about, or were you just eliminating opponents that sort of seemed vulnerable?
Yeah, no, it's nothing we talked about. I just caught him out of position and got a kill. That's about it.
Okay. All right. And of course, my final question for you is, currently, I honestly believe the Los Angeles Gladiators seem unstoppable. Is there a team in the playoffs currently that you are wary of?
I think the only team that I'm like a little bit iffy about is like Shanghai. Because I haven't really played them, and I know they're a good team, but I believe we can win.
All right, so Shanghai. Ooh, that's going to be a fun match. Los Angeles Gladiators versus Shanghai. I will definitely keep an eye out for that. Kevster, with that being said, I am going to end the interview here. Thank you so much. And again, big congratulations.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Let's go back to the deck, not the desk.
Get back to us. And with this victory, the Gladiators are moving on to the next round and are currently awaiting their opponent, very much like the Dallas Fuel. We still have more matches to go, though. I can't believe that we're only halfway through the day, because it's been going on for some time. I'm not going to lie to you. All the more fun for us still to come. But let's recap all the action that we just got to watch, because quite frankly, this has been one of the most anticipated matchups for you, especially in Force, as you did tell us during our pre-show. Now, I of course need to know, did those teams live up to your expectations? Because when we were watching the match backstage, you didn't seem to be super sold on the way the Philadelphia Fusion were trying to shoehorn together their comps.
Yeah, it definitely felt like the Gladiators were way more comfortable with what they were playing. It felt like they had an idea of what they wanted to play on each round, each map. While the Fusion, I think me and Custer, we talked about it backstage, them not being willing to play the Tracer Sombra out of the get-go on Ilios, it was a pretty good tell that, like, hey, we're not comfortable playing the Tracer Sombra composition. It's not what we're great at, and that's not how we defeat the LA Gladiators. Instead, we saw Shockwave flex over to the Echo, which worked a lot better on Temple of Anubis. You know, it's a closed area. You can utilize the duplication to go into D.Va and contest the point a lot of times. So the Philadelphia Fusion, it felt like they weren't comfortable playing the meta, so to speak, quotation marks, playing the Tracer Sombra with the Senyata and the Wrecking Ball, and instead they tried to force a lot of switches. I like what Sideshow said during the match on Havana, actually, when he commented on that Philadelphia Fusion, it felt like they were individually trying to swap over to different heroes to break the LA Gladiators down. But there was no uniform, like, team swap composition there to try to beat the Gladiators as a team instead. So the Fusion, I do think they have the individual skill required. We can't talk enough about this backline of theirs, but they have to improve some of these compositional swaps, because it always felt like they were in the back foot. It didn't feel like they were running the tempo, especially on Havana, as we saw on second point and third point. And instead, the Gladiators, they were in control in the most of this match.
And it's actually interesting. I want to see who is going to come up with a solution for the Los Angeles Gladiators double flex support backline. They played it on Kings Row and Havana with the double shield. With Skewed being a flex support player, he just looked so dominant on that Zenyatta, and it allows, you know, Shu to play that Baptiste, and they can even flip it in the middle of a map if they want to. That's how talented they are. I don't think I've seen a team yet shown an ability to be able to break that, and I'm curious to see if anyone is going to be able to beat it in the playoffs, and it's probably going to be the Shanghai Dragons who are going to be up to that task.
So based on those first few performances of the teams, Danny, how do you rank it? Who do you see like going for? Who exceeded your expectations, rather?
Exceeded. I mean, I had high expectations for everyone. I mean, Dallas Fuel, I knew they were going to be pretty good. Actually, Gladiators.